Can you hear me? Can you hear me?
We in? We talking?
We're talking. Can you hear my voice?
I can hear you loud and clear. Can you hear me?
Beautiful, beautiful, beautiful.
Hey, am I sitting in the right spot? What do I do?
You're looking so good.
Bro, thank you.
So good.
Geez, I had a hard time coming here this morning. But
tell me about it. You all are getting a lot of rain?
Well, mate, we're getting so much rain, it's insane. We got like all night last night down in Sydney, the whole place is just it's not normal, Shawnee. It is not normal.
So what do you think it is? The global warming, or is it just like once in a 10-year storm, or what's going on?
Well, you know what? You know, they're saying it could be global warming. I've seen, in my opinion, it's it could be partly climate warming or all that stuff. But, you know, it's not the first time. You know, I've been through a few La Ninas over the years and I haven't seen it before. But they're saying it's getting a little bit more regular, but this has been the worst one for that I can remember, though. Absolutely.
Well, you're shopping.
It's messing with the, hey, Shawnee, it's messing with the surf down here in good old Newey.
Is it brown?
Shit, yeah. It is so brown. It's bull shark brown, brother.
So are you, is the runoff so bad you can't get in?
Well, that's what happened this morning. I couldn't get in the roads, and I'm like, you know, 1 minute from the beach. And the road going over to Redhead, to where I'm sitting right now, I had to do a detour and go up and around, down through Charlestown and Dudley and all that place, just to come back down through the hill because we couldn't get across the creek down at Redhead. And it was just washing through big time.
Well, let me first say, man, thank you so much for taking the time to speak with me. And it's so, so, so good to see you in person. I mean, like on this video, and I'm so happy to just like be in your presence. So thank you.
Well, shit, Shawnee, you know, we go way back. So, you know, it's pretty awesome to finally actually do this. It's taken me, you know, I'm such not an IT dude. So, thanks for the coaching, bro. Thanks for the coaching.
You popped right in. It worked out.
Just slid right in.
Yeah.
Just sat down. I don't know if you can see in the background. I'm just about to do a board for the WSL for the GLAN competition.
Beautiful. And,
I'm just about to start. It's a 6'6". I don't know if you can see it. I just started it this morning, but you know, while I was waiting around, can't really see anything at the moment. So
is this for the competition, Peter?
Ah, what a hassle! Hey, got ya. Now where were we?
Oh, where were we? Yes, and is this okay? Is this an okay time for you? Are you all right?
There's no good time for me, man.
All right. Well,
this is as good as any.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, thank you so much then again for your time. And you were saying, is this a board to be used in GLAN or as a trophy?
Yes, I think it is. Yeah. It's gonna be it's an old retro one, like the ones we had back in the day. Single fin, and it's going to be all camoed out.
I can't wait to see it. And
I'll flick you some shots later.
That would be epic. That would be super epic.
So okay. How you been going?
Man, really good. You know, I have three kids now, so they take up most of my time, and just trying to raise them right here on the beach, raise them as surfers, and just, you know, like you, just keep pounding, selling people the art, and keep breathing every day and living. That's the name of the game. Dude, number one, I can't tell you how much love I have in my heart that that is hanging in your studio, man. Like, super deep.
Well, I've been carrying that around for a while.
Dude, that's literally like the first piece I ever made in my life.
No shit.
Yep. And thousands later, you know, like, so yeah, we're still doing it. And yeah, so much respect.
Yeah, no probs.
So should we begin?
May as well. What are we? Right. Don't ask too deep.
Yeah, we won't get too deep. And is there a hard stop time you need me to stick to here?
I don't know. Just let it go and just keep going. I'm still standing.
All right, and you tell me if you got a split or run, okay?
Yes, wait.
All right, so let me do my quick introduction here. All right, so here we go. Hello, this is Sean Rutier. You're listening to Speaking from Water, episode 13. And I'm here with the legendary Peter McCabe from Newcastle, Australia. Peter is one of the most epic, legendary surfboard shaper surfers that we have with us on the earth today. And he is gracious enough to spend some time and tell us a little bit about his knowledge regarding the aesthetic of water, how he operates with water, and how he shapes his sculptures to ride through water. So without any further ado, Peter, thank you so much for being with us. And how are you?
Yeah, thanks, Sean. Thanks for having me. And let's keep this thing rolling before I fizzle it.
So I want to kind of turn back the clock a little bit. I want to go back to Newcastle in the day when you found this love for water. Tell me a little bit about how you became a surfer in this world.
Shit. Well, it all started when I moved up to Newcastle from Narooma, when my dad was a pilot down there. Then he moved up to Newey, and then and we had the house that we were in was the closest house to Nobby's Beach, you know, like was literally, you know, 30-second walk to the beach. And then right from there, I was probably eight at the time. And then I met a couple of guys, and then they were just starting to surf. So this was like, you know, 64, something like that. Big old boards. And I can still remember the first time I even paddled out at Nobby's was the May school holidays. It was freezing cold. I was on this big old 9.8 Gordon Woods. And, you know, I just caught that one wave just in the white water. And Sean, that's all she wrote. I haven't stopped since, close to 60 years ago. Or maybe more. Yeah, 60 years ago, nearly. And haven't stopped since. And then that just took me, you know, just from, you know, almost from that day on, I just, you know, I couldn't get enough of the surf. Let's put it that way. Much to the my parents' disdain, if you want to put it that way. But they came around eventually.
So your mom, I read, was doing some reading, owned a sandwich shop.
Yeah, that came quite a few years later. That was just down the road from us, from the house. Everything just revolved around the East End up there at Newey at that time. You know, it was a pretty special time to be growing up and surfing as a kid. And, you know, there wasn't too much action going on at that time. Just me, my brothers, pretty much just surfing those, you know, late 60s, early 70s, right through to now, I guess.
Yeah, so you've been at the same beach, which is an epic beach for those who might not know. Newcastle, Australia, it has all sorts of nooks and crannies. If the wind is going one way, you can go to a place offshore. And if the swell is coming one way, you can hit the swell directly. So the beach is extremely favorable for surfing, all sorts of different breaks. How has it been growing up in a place and seeing it over the years where the only thing I'm sure that's really changed so much are the boards?
Oh, no, Sean, it's the whole of Newcastle's changed dramatically over the last 50 years, you know, and especially in the last 10 to 15 years, it's just changed so much. It's, you know, it'd be almost unrecognizable since you were here. And, but, you know, that's nearly everywhere in the whole world. You know, there's not too many places that are still the same, you know, as they were 40 or 50 years ago as they are today. So
what do you remember fondly of the surf culture in those times?
Well, basically having it all to yourself years and years on end, pretty much. And you know, and then just everybody I've met through surfing and then the whole town of Newry, you know, it's been I've had a pretty amazing surfing life through Newry, I have to say. You know, a couple of ups and downs here and there, but all good.
So when did you know that you wanted to get into shaping? Like, how did that process start?
Well, me and my brother were just mucking around at first, just shaping them in the backyard. But really, I didn't really get into it till I was, you know, I was just surfing, and then I ended up going fixing dings for Sam Egan, and then it just progressed from there. And then, you know, the more you surf, the more you wanted to get a surfboard for yourself, and then ended up going. I remember Terry Fitzgerald telling me one time we were doing something, I was with Fitzy, and he just said, "Peter, you just got to go and shape your own boards, man. You know, there's nothing like having your own boards. You'll get what you want." And then I did that. And then, you know, and it's like every shaper would know that, you know, their first board they ever made was like, "Fuck, this is the best board I've ever had." You know, "Wow, this is insane." But in reality, they were probably just heaps of shit. And but you just love them. Probably not unlike one of those first paintings of yours. So, you know, they're just the best. And then as you get into it, and then you just learn more and more about, you know, everything. And then as a surfer, you know, you go, "Fuck, I need this, I need that. You know, it's got to be this." So, and at that stage, we've gone through so many boards, you know, and then just for yourself, you know, I'd be just going, "Oh, one," and, "Oh shit, that's even shit." And then you'd be doing the next, go and do another one the next day till you know. And it's still pretty much today, you know, you can still make yourself a whole bunch of, you know, pile of boards. And then, you know, there's always going to be one or two boards that are just exceptional. The other ones will go good, you know, but, and that's even with all the computer stuff today, you still can't get, you know, two boards the same exactly. There's always going to be one, you know, there's a magic one, and no one really knows for sure what it comes down to. You know, some of the best boards I've ever had, the fins have been all over the place, you know, nothing straight, you know, all sorts of stuff. And they've just been like super magic boards. And then, you know, I've had a lot of boards, I have to say.
So tell me about that first moment when you're like, you got to shape your own board. You're thinking in your head, what was it about the boards at the time that you said to yourself, "I can do better than this," when it came to your surfing? Like, how did you know that you could do better?
That's a tricky one. I'm not sure. I don't have a real lot of patience. So, you know, I wasn't really into the aesthetics and stuff so much. But, you know, it's actually just working with a lot of other, well, just hanging out with a lot of really good surfers like Gerry and everyone. And Gerry was, you know, instrumental in shaping a lot of boards for me. And, you know, just changing from, you know, everything was just changing so quick, you know, almost weekly, daily almost at one stage, you know, because you just go somewhere and then some, you know, another friend of mine would have a body just shaped and I'm just going, oh, and it was going unreal shit. I got to get something like that. And, you know, then, you know, I'd imagine it'd be like that with everybody, all the shapers, all the guys. And then pretty much that's how I just kept going at it, you know, just kept going, going, going. You know, I've never said I was there, you know, unreal. I just know what I like. And the hardest part with us, so there's a difference shaping. Everything I do is custom, and it's really hard to not push what I like, you know, everybody hates pretty much, or the opposite, you know, people come in, you know, and that's always been the case, you know, shaping boards, not, you know, I've gone from just doing heaps and heaps of stuff now and just purely boutique, dude, purely boutique. And yeah, that's just how it is, bro.
Well, that's the thing. You are a true artist in the sense that you're there creating sculptures. And if people like it, they love it. Or if they don't like it, well, peace out. You know, like your art is the pinnacle of it. So, you know, if they want something factory made, they can go down the road, right?
Absolutely. And there's a lot of surf shops all around.
Well, I know I was extremely lucky to find you through our mutual friend, Double D. In 2001, you made me these gems of sculptures right here. So I'm very—
Oh, wow, you still got those?
Oh, bro, I treat them like, you know, the gold they are. So they draw very much radiance of inspiration. So like you know, these sculptures, they're very particular, you know, they have a degree of the waves that need to be ridden with these boards are like the most epic waves. And you are known as Mr. G-Land. You famously went to G-Land and discovered it with Gerry Lopez. Before we kind of maybe dabble in what that is like going there, what got you to say to yourself, I need to get out of Newcastle? Because Newcastle is a pretty crazy place. Like, as far as waves go, you get all sorts of different waves. Like, when did you say to yourself, I need to leave? I needed to go discover new things at a time that was very frontierish?
Well, that's a long story in itself, Sean. But in a nutshell, I was with Steve Cooney and a few guys, Mitchell Ray and Glenn, down when they were just going over to do Morning of the Earth. And at the time I was in Hawaii, and then I was with, once again, with Terry Fitz, and Terry's gone, hey, Pete, you got to go to Bali, man. But I'd already known about Bali through Steve Cooney. And anyways, you know, after that, I've just come back from Hawaii. And then me and my good friend, Tony Elthington, were down at South Australia for the Australian titles. And it was so bad. It was so bad down there that we just bailed out halfway through, drove home. And then I said, hey, let's go to Bali. Let's just get out of here. We need to get somewhere anyway. Okay. And then so me and my two good friends from Niue, we took off and just bought a ticket, just went. Didn't even know where we were going. And that was in 75. And then Tony turned up a couple of weeks later, Dick Hull, and then the rest was history. and the rest of it's just, but that was how I got out. It was, you know, sort of a lot longer story than that, Sean, obviously, but, you know.
Tell me a little bit about you arrive and you don't really know where you're going. Like, what's that experience like at that time? Because, you know, these
days. Yeah, well, that was awesome. We took it all in. We just landed. And then I ended up staying at a legendary Balinese surfers place, Ketut Menda. And we ended up staying at his place right there at Kuta Reef. There was nothing around. And still to this day, me and Ketut Menda are absolutely best friends still. And I got him into surfing big time. And but that very first time was just magical. My very first surf was Kuta Reef. And it took us ages to find Ulu, just driving around because there wasn't many people there at the time. In fact, there was no one, hardly. And then, but that first trip out to Ulu when we finally found it, and I can remember the very first day we went out, my friend actually went down and just went. He was straight out there, and I'm just going, we can't surf that, because it was the low tide racetrack. And then I watched. I went, no way. And he went down. There's no one in the water. He's never been there. He's straight down, straight out. And I'm watching from up on the cliff. And then I just seen him catch his first wave, and I went, holy moly, how do you get out there? And then I was out there, and it was just pretty much all she wrote, Shawnee boy.
Do you remember that first wave?
Absolutely. Yeah, it was just perfect. Inside corner, just the racetrack, as we call it now. And it was just, you know, I thought they were too fast looking at it when no one was riding it. But then when you get out there, it was just, it was a cakewalk. You know, it was just too easy. Compared to Nobby's Bank, let's put it that way.
So the boards you brought on that trip were effective for the wave you found?
Nope. They were just the boards I had. And but it turns out they were pretty good. Sam Egan made that first one I went. It was a classic 7-footer. You know, thinking back on a day, but it was just a hell board. And but no, you know, I had no idea what would take, and I think I took three boards. I had a 7-foot, 7-9, and an 8-3 that I had from only a few months before in Hawaii. So that was me.
Were those?
And there was a day at the outside corner not long after that. But I needed every inch of that 8-3. I tell you. It was massive.
Were these boards that you shaped?
Nope. No, boards that Sam Egan had shaped for me. Yeah.
So
I'd had shaped some boards. I'd already been shaping, but I just got Sam to do it because, you know, I was a little bit rough around the edges, let's put it that way.
When you departed, did you gain, like, what, how did you gain the knowledge to make the thing that you needed to then do better in the next time? Like, what were the things that were going through your mind as you were riding these waves that other people had shaped? What were the particulars that brought you to say, I need to do this?
I don't think that part came into, you know, quite a few years after those first days, you know, especially like the next year, and then the one year I had some boards that weren't as good as the ones I had the year before. And then I got one off Gerry, or it wasn't, I didn't actually get it off him. I just took it. And it was one of those magic ones. And So I just used that. There was two of them, two exactly the same boards, but one was miles in front of the other. So we used to arm wrestle for it all the time. But yeah, but that, in saying that, with the, you know, the boards, with me just making specific boards for when I want, that probably didn't come to, you know, quite a few years, you know, like from probably from 78 onwards, you know, because I went from them boards down to, you know, surfing tiny little skinny boards. And then, you know, but well, you're starting to test me now, dude. No.
Gather the aesthetic of this water that you were in G-Land in this time period. Can you recall, can you bring us into this, in, into this substance? What describe it if you could?
You mean how I just
like is it super blue? Are the winds offshore a lot? Like
Well, G-Land's just one of those places where it's, you know, during the season, it's just, there's probably nowhere else in the world, pretty much, although a lot of Indo is. But yeah, you just wake up, it's offshore every day, the water. It can change, you know, it can be as blue as and clear some days. And then other days, it's just, it's still sort of clear, but it's got a, you know, I don't know what it is floating through there, you know. Happens down here a lot. You know, different currents change the color of the water big time. The winds, how strong they are, and everything will change the color of the water. You know, obviously clouds, sunlight, all of you know more than me.
You'd been to Hawaii though. What did it strike you
as? I've been to Hawaii a lot.
Well, you'd been there before G-Land. What did it strike you as, tamer than Hawaii or on the same level? Did Hawaii prepare you?
A lot tamer. Of course, it's a lot tamer. And, you know, I can have their moments. It can be just as radical, but it's, yeah, there's nothing like Hawaii, you know, no chance. But, you know, it's a different deal, you know. It's just, you know, G-Land, Padang, Ulu, all the Mentawais, all of those places, everything's coming, and it's coming from a long way. But the when they hit the reefs, everything's a lot, you know, everything's a lot lined up. There's no wild water moving most of the time, you know. I mean, you can get it. I mean, G-Land does get pretty wild with the extreme tides, and Uluwatu for that matter. But, you know, that's about the only time when there's a big swell and the big tides can make some serious, hideous currents to deal with.
Was there any surf culture there when you arrived, or was it?
No. No, not in G-Land. No. And even in Bali, it was starting though. Yeah, absolutely starting. There's a lot of hippies, a lot of guys. They're all on the trail surfing. But it was definitely, you know, Steve Cooney and Wayne Lynch and all those guys that Gerry, they went down in that middle 70s, you know. But definitely Steve Cooney was, in my mind, was the one that kicked it all off for Indo, absolutely. And the guy was just ripping, you know. He was just an amazing surfer and just, you know, just being out there by himself. Just, yeah, I can't say enough about Steve Cooney, I have to tell you.
So what what is it about Steve that got him to do what he was doing? As you say, you know, you can't say enough about him.
Well, he's just an amazing surfer. At the time, we were just kids. I remember when he was, said he was going over there, and then we had to go and get, I had to go and get my mum's atlas because he said, "Hey, I'm going to Bali." I went, "Shit, where the hell is that?" And then, so I go home. "Hey, mum, get me my atlas. We're looking for Bali. We can't find it anywhere. There's no Bali on the atlas because it's Indonesia. We had to be looking for Indonesia." It took me a while to figure that out too.
So
but Steve was, you know, he was this amazing surfer. And then when they did Morning of the Earth, you know, you only got to go and watch that, and then you'll understand what I'm saying.
I do, and we'll put a link in the description below for sure. You know, this whole thing is really all about educating the youth, stoking them out. In this time, kids have everything at their fingertips. You know, they can go to Indonesia on their phone. Back then, you had to look in an atlas made of paper. You had no idea where it was. There was no Google Earth. But this speaks to something that we all know, and that's the stoke. And the stoke is what gets you out there. What gets you going. Can you say a little bit about that then, and how that's carried you through your life to this day? I mean, this morning we were texting at 4 a.m. You were up, you were checking it. Like when I visited you 20 years ago, you were on the beach checking it at dawn. Like, what is it about this stoke in the water that just drives the insides of you?
Well, I'm not doing it as much as I was 20 or 30 years ago, because I can just, I'm like the kids now. I just look, get on my phone and check it out. But, you know, but it's still there. There's nothing like going down and checking it out yourself. And, you know, it's a lot different. You can look at it on the phone and check every cam in the whole East Coast. But it's all good when you, you know, get down, check it out by your own eyes. And go, "Oh, yeah, we'll go here," you know, because you look at something, "Oh, yeah, let's go over here." Yeah, but it's still good, you know. There's nothing like getting up and cruising down at gentlemen's hours and the surf's right there, you know, this far down the line, bro.
epic. How do you see where the surfing world has come from and gone, as a person who's been living it from the infancy to this time today, where, you know, magazines are gone, they're obsolete, but the artist still survives, the artist still lives. What is your perspective on the world right now?
I don't know. All I know is you just got to keep paddling. And you know, it's changed so much. You know what? I go down the beach and there's heaps of kids everywhere, and they're just as stoked as I was 50 years ago. You know, and they don't know any different. They, you know, if there's not 50 guys out in the water, they think it's no good. You know, and you know, but they're just as stoked. I mean, absolutely just a stoke. I get kids coming all the time. I got to do a couple of little boards for kids. And it's just something about surfing that that's never going to change, you know. And it'd be just the same as you from when you'd have to remember your first wave.
100%.
And, you know, and that's probably every surfer in the whole goddamn world. Yeah, you know, that could, you know, and it's, you know, as through the generations, and you can just see, I just see so many dads with their kids now, and their kids are just like, you know, just going mental. And there's so many women and girls surfing these days too, you know, and they're surfing amazing, the girls, you know. So it's really that's changed a lot since when we started. There were some some girl surfers, but not a whole lot. Not like now. They're everywhere. They're awesome.
Absolutely. I have a 10-year-old girl, got her out there as soon as, you know, she could. And you gotta get the kids out there, basically. I wanna kind of shift gears from the sculptures that you make, as in surfboards, to the painting that you do on your surfboards. And your print and your paintings are unique. I'd like to know how you got that inspiration. Was it from your time in Bali? Where does that come from?
You mean the camo ones?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Well, that comes from Gerry. He was in, I think he was in Spain, and he sent me a letter because we'd just been in G-Land, and then he wanted some boards, and he said, he asked me to build him two boards to go for G-Land when we were going to meet up. But while he was over in Spain filming for Conan, when they were doing downtime, he was making all these model airplanes and painting them in camo. So he sends me this stuff. He goes, "Petey, I want you to do the boards in camo. I want this." And I went, "What do you mean? You mean you want, like, you know, the Western Front, North Russian Winter, or what? What the go?" And he just said, "Well, I don't know. Just do it. I want them camo." And so anyway, I did. He still got those two boards, by the way. And but the thing was, we did them, not thinking of my boards at the time were clear, or they had some colors on them. But then when I realized we're doing these like 8-10 hour days surfing nonstop, and we're getting so sunburnt. But then when we got the camo boards, we realized there was no glare. We weren't getting and our faces weren't getting burnt, and our eyes particularly weren't getting burnt. And then I went, and then we'd go from the, then, you know, maybe the swell come up and I had to go and use me 7-footer, which was clear. And then I'd go out, even though we had, you know, didn't have a whole lot of sunscreen, but then you just get nuked by the glare from the surfboard, from the water, everything, all the glare, really. And we noticed that it just stopped almost instantly. So we went, wow, we put it together, you know, we figured it out that, you know, just basically any colors probably would, you know, any sort of colors would have done it. But we just ran with the camo to stop the glare, and sure as hell did work. And that's where that come from, and stuck with it, and been doing it for ever since. I've got to do this one I'm leaning on now. It's got to be that exact same stuff.
I mean,
so there it is, Shawnee, in a nutshell.
Dude, I'm blown away. I didn't know the utility was as such. And it's so iconic to your work. I actually picked up, you know, I've the boards I was lucky enough to get from you are camo. And then I was in a surf shop, Surf City Surf Shop, a local place here. And they had a Lopez with the camo on it. And I'm going to show it to you real quick. And do you know anything about this one?
You know, I don't know.
Yeah.
But it's not one of Double D's ones, is it?
No, it had nothing to do with Double D. I just saw it and I was like, I have to have that because I you know, I have the camos from you, and I know you and Lopez are boys, and I thought, you know, that is that's something.
Yeah, JL did heaps of them like that. Yeah. But anyway.
But Peter, I know you're super busy, and I'm gonna wrap this up, but I've two kind of like macro deep questions for you.
Yeah, I told you no deep.
No deep. All right. first, what kind of advice would you give to, you know, young kids who might want to get into surfboard shaping in these times? You spoke earlier, there's boards that are being made by machines. There's sculptures that you're making. How does a young person or a person navigate this space in this time?
That's going to be really hard for young guys coming up now to do that. You know what? You know, shaping with that, to do it commercially, I don't know. Right now, I'd just say go and do something else. It's so hard to get into it. I'm just fortunate that I've been doing it for forever. I've never done anything else. So, and for me, everything's changed so much, Sean. I really can't give anyone any advice on that. People know right away, you know, how they're going to do it. Some people, you know, because making a surfboard is not real easy. You know, it may look easy, but it sure as hell isn't. And a lot of kids these days just don't have the patience. They just want to be able to do it right then. And it takes years. Not just shaping the board, you can get that off a machine, but just to know where you're going to put your fins, and just to know how to glass it, how to sand it, how to, you know, get everything going. You know, there's such a lot to it that a lot of people are just starting to realize it these, you know, now after all these years, but still, you know, until they're actually done it. That's why it's really hard now to find anybody to do anything, you know, kids just not there, you know, and to make a living out of it right now, the training, because they, you know, that's why they're just, that's, I can't really give anybody any advice on that one right now, Shawnee. But they know if they're going to be able to do it, you know, or not. But it's hard, let me tell you.
Hard work.
A lot of hard work. And yeah, you're just doing it because you love it and it's the lifestyle. And, that's basically it.
Now, my last question to you. What is the meaning of life according to Peter McCabe?
Is that a question?
It's whatever you want it to make it.
Ah, sure. You know, this far down the line, I'm just still happy to be standing here, standing in the shaping room, messing around boards. I figured it out. Don't need a whole lot of stuff these days. So, for me, it's just been it's been like the blink of an eye, I have to tell you. So, but still here, and that's, hopefully I'll still be standing here in a few more years. And it's been great talking with you, and we'll have to do this again.
Peter, the honor has been mine, and let me tell you, you look the same that I remember you 20 years ago. So you're doing something right, and you're, yes, you're a true living legend, and it's been amazing to hear your perspective. So thank you very much for joining us today.
No, it's my pleasure. Thank you, Shawnee, and thanks for having me and going through all to get me organized. You've done real well to get me.
I was looking back at the text, and we started in May of last year. Yeah. And I don't want to press them too much, but I'm not going to give up.
Yeah. Don't worry. That's the story of my life. Yeah. But it works out in the end.
Epic. Well, that's a wrap. And okay, hey, before I let you go, is Dwayne still with you?
Yes, Dwayne's around. I was with him on the weekend.
All right. All right.
Yeah, I'll tell him that you.
Tell him I said hello.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
Is he still lifeguarding?
No. He's working on the wharfs. He's making a few boards, and he's in love. And he's going good.
Good.
I'll tell him for sure.
Yeah, fond memories of Dwayne, and you know, hanging out with you guys at the Shaping Bay, and you know, my time in Newcastle was fundamental. Yeah, you can have that. But Peter. Oh, one more thing. How's that truck? That van truck you have is.
Yeah. Yeah, I'll send you some more photos. It's awesome.
Yeah.
I just picked it up. That's what I'm going to do. I'm going to be just driving around, going surfing and up and down the coast. Yeah. It's not fitted out in the back yet, but I'm about to. It's not a new one. It's old.
Oh, yeah. No.
Yeah, but it's perfect. It's just perfect.
Camo print, wood. Yeah. Yeah, dude, legendary.
I thought you'd like that. I just took that as I was getting into it when I was leaving this morning at 8:00.
Yeah.
And then that's when we got caught up in all the rain and shit. But anyway, I thought, I'll send him this.
Beautiful. Oh, man. So good.
Okay, bro. I got to fly.
All right, Peter. Thank you again. We'll be in touch.
Okay, mate.
Thanks, buddy. See ya.
Bye. Thanks. Bye. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye, kids. Bye.